The Monastery of Monte Cassino, 80 miles south of Rome. Close by is Rocca Secca, birthplace of Thomas Aquinas. In the valley of the River Liri, an ancient landscape renews itself every spring. In early 1944, Allied armies came to Cassino as they advanced towards Rome. In March, the Irish Brigade joined what was to become one of the longest battles in Western Europe in the Second World War. I am Richard O'Sullivan, and this is part 5 of All My Brothers, the story of the Irish Brigade in the Second World War. In September 1943, Allied armies landed on the Italian mainland. British Prime Minister Winston Churchill said it was the Third Reich's soft underbelly. Earlier that month, the Italian government joined the Allies as a co-belligerent. German armies immediately occupied the Italian peninsula. They built defensive lines anchored on rivers flowing east and west from the Apennine Mountains. For 3 months, the 8th Army under General Bernard Montgomery advanced along the Adriatic coast. The 5th Army, led by US General Mark Clark, attacked in the west. By the end of 1943, the Allies had reached the Winter Line, also known as the Gustav Line. It ran from the mouth of the Garigliano River on the Tyrrhenian coast, through the Apennines, and along the Sangro River Valley to the Adriatic. One of its strong points in the west was Monte Cassino. Allied commanders decided to concentrate resources on the western end of the Gustav Line. On the 12th of January 1944, the French Expeditionary Corps advanced into the mountains north of Monte Cassino in the first of the 5th Army's phased attacks on the line. The aim was to outflank Monastery Mount, cut the road to Rome, and prevent the Germans transferring forces to Anzio, where an amphibious landing was planned. On the 17th of January, attacks began over the Garigliano River near the coast. And on the night of the 19th of January, the US 36th Texan Division started to cross the Gari River south of Cassino town. A firm bridgehead on the west bank of the Garigliano was secured, but the American attack across the Gari was repulsed. This set the scene for an amphibious landing behind German lines at Anzio on the 22nd of January. It was initially successful, but by the end of the month, the Anzio bridgehead was under German counterattack. Meanwhile, Algerian, Moroccan, and Tunisian units in the French army captured high points north of Monte Cassino. On the 24th of January, American forces crossed the Rapido in support of the French army. They captured the village of Kaira and got within 400 yards of the monastery. The attacks encountered ferocious resistance, supply difficulties, and freezing weather. The first attempt to break the Gustav Line at Cassino ended on the 12th of February. A fresh plan called for the New Zealand Corps, which included British and Indian Army divisions, to break the Gustav Line at Monte Cassino itself. It was commanded by General Bernard Freyberg, who had won the Victoria Cross in the Great War. The Allies believed the monastery was being used for military purposes. On the 15th of February, it was destroyed by bombers. That night, British units started to attack strong points north of Monastery Mount. On the night of the 17th of February, the 4th Indian Division joined the assault on Monte Cassino. In the valley, New Zealanders crossed the Rapido and attacked Cassino Town. All the attacks were thwarted. The second attempt to take Monte Cassino was called off on the 18th of February. A new assault plan was devised. On the 15th of March, the 4th Indian Division again attacked towards Monastery Mount. The New Zealanders tried once more to capture Cassino Town, which had been pulverised by Allied bombs and shelling. The 78th Division of the British Army, including the Irish Brigade, was attached to the New Zealand Corps and had been designated to lead the second phase of the attack, which involved breaking into the Leary Valley. The Irish Brigade was formed in early 1942. It comprised the 1st Battalion of the Royal Irish Fusiliers, known as the Fogs, the 6th Battalion of the Royal Inniskilling Fusiliers, known as the Skins, also based in Northern Ireland, and the 2nd Battalion of the London Irish Rifles, which came from London. Most of the original members of the brigade were Irish-born or of Irish descent. The Tunisian campaign was the brigade's baptism of fire. It lost around 1,000 men, either killed, wounded, missing or taken prisoner, in battles between November 1942 and the fall of Tunis in May 1943. The brigade set sail from the port of Sousse on the 26th and 27th of July and land in Sicily the following day. In September 1943, the brigade sailed to Italy and joined the 8th Army on the Adriatic coast. It spent 8 weeks on the front line and suffered more than 800 casualties by the time it was relieved on the 5th of December 1943. The brigade spent the winter on the front line in the high Apennines north of Naples. At the end of February, they travelled to Italy's western coastal plain near Capua to prepare to join the battle for Cassino. That month, Brigadier Nelson Russell, who had commanded the Irish Brigade since it landed in North Africa, became ill. He was replaced by Pat Scott, former commanding officer of the Fogs and the London Irish. Scott was to lead the brigade until the end of the war. On the 22nd of March, the Irish Brigade moved to the east bank of the Garry River, opposite the village of San Angelo di Via Dice. It was the last full day of the third Cassino battle.
We could see coloured smoke, which identified Allied positions. Every now and again, there would be a lull in the fighting, and ambulances with large Red Cross flags slowly drove up the track towards the monastery and back. The monastery itself was a complete ruin, stark and forbidding in the sunlight. Probably the most international army in the world formed that year in Italy. Against us was an army with many members conscripted from occupied Europe. It was a vast international array and a complete waste of humanity and resources.
The third Cassino attack was called off. There was a 7-week interlude as the Allies prepared for an irresistible assault on the whole Cassino front from the Tyrrhenian Sea to the Abruzzo Mountains. The 78th Division moved to new locations in the Cassino area. For the Irish Brigade, it was on and around Monte Castellone, a 2,300-foot high point overlooking Monte Cassino. For 4 nights, starting on the 29th of March, the 3 battalions of the brigade crossed the Rapido Valley to Caira. The Fogs stayed in the town. The London Irish and the Skins scaled Castelloni to relieve the 4th Tunisian Rifle Regiment. I'm now in the village of Caira, and behind me in the mist is Monte Castelloni. For 4 weeks in April 1944, Caira was the HQ of the Irish Brigade. At the time, it was described as the most heavily shelled area in Italy. The brigade held positions in Caira and on Castelloni for almost a month. During the day, men hid in sangars and minimised movements that could attract mortars, shelling and machine gun fire. At night, patrols were sent to dominate no man's land. Fox Major Lawrence Franklin Vale, an Australian who had joined the British Army, described the conditions in a letter to his wife Olive, who was in England with his baby daughter Valerie.
I'm writing this letter in a small dugout on the side of a mountain. There is very little room. It has been made fairly snug by hanging blankets around the sides and over the entrance while the roof is covered with logs. Outside is the constant sound of machine gun fire, and at the moment someone is firing Tommy guns and our mortars are firing. Every now and again comes the crump of the German mortars, and then perhaps a short spell of silence. Just as I wrote this, there was a tremendous burst of machine gun fire on our left and the crash of mortars on the right. This is a normal, uneventful night in the line, and no special attack is occurring. It is just what happens every night.
The Skins were closest to the monastery in an area known as Phantom Ridge. Skins Lieutenant John Wilton, an Oxford University student when he was called up in 1941, called out one night to check sentries in a forward position. He was accompanied by a lance corporal, a rugged Irish regular. They found the sentries were fast asleep.
When we got a little nearer to these two, we heard snoring. The corporal crawled behind these chaps, took his bayonet out of his scabbard and laid it against one of them. "I'll cut your bloody throat for you." He left the two of them back to back, keeping each other awake by trembling, and we didn't have any more problems of that sort.
On the 24th of April, the brigade was replaced on Castelloni by the Polish Corps, which had been given the task of capturing the monastery in the next Allied attack. It began with a massive artillery bombardment at 11 o'clock on the night of the 11th of May. The Allies attacked across a front of more than 20 miles. More than 200,000 troops were involved. The 78th Division, including the Irish Brigade, was given the task of following up the initial breakthrough across the Gari into the Liri Valley. On the night of the 11th of May, the 4th Infantry Division and the 8th Indian Division attacked across the Gari to create a bridgehead. By the end of the 12th of May, the first bridge over the river was completed, allowing tanks to support the bridgehead. That night, the 78th Division moved up to the Gari and prepared to join the fighting. Prior to this, Ted O'Sullivan had suffered a recurrence of the malaria he had contracted in Sicily. He was sent to Bari for evacuation to Libya, but Ted was determined to rejoin his comrades. He got up early on the 13th of May and hitched a ride across the peninsula to Naples, and from there to the London Irish by the Gari.
I was greeted with hugs from E Company Sergeant Major George Charnick and Sergeant Jock McNally, and with a kiss from Sergeant Eddie Mayo. I was able to join my friends in one of the greatest epics of the Second World War, but would I live to regret my efforts?
The Irish Brigade's task was to cross the Gari, advance 2 miles through the Gustav Line to the fortified hamlet of Sinagoga, and cut Highway 6, the road to Rome. The Skins led the way. They waited east of the Gari until the Congo Bailey Bridge was completed on the morning of the 14th of May. The Fox and London Irish shelter behind Monte Trocchio, about 1 mile further back. London Irish 2nd in command, Major John Horsfall, described the conditions there that day in his book, Fling Your Banner to the Wind.
It was a cheerless, stunted spot, and the hillside looked as though a hurricane had struck it. Seared and torn under the shelling, one would remember the destruction, and the satanic hiss of splinters as they ripped through the olive trees every few seconds. For several hours that afternoon, Monte Trocchio was a screaming madhouse.
The Skins crossed Congo Bridge, and were followed later that day by the Fogs and the London Irish. This is the Garry River, and I am standing at the site of Congo Bridge, which was completed on the morning of the 14th of May. In the afternoon, the Skins crossed here and assembled in this area and remained under enemy fire for 12 hours. They were followed the following day by the London Irish Rifles and the Fogs. The plan of attack called for 11th Brigade and the Irish Brigade to advance in parallel. The Skins set off at 3 o'clock in the morning on the 15th of May. They advanced cautiously through routes cleared of barbed wire and mines. In darkness before dawn, the Skins reached the Pier Peto, a stream which blocked its line of advance. A bridge had been built, but a British tank got stuck, blocking the way ahead for vehicles. The Skins crossed and pressed on without supporting armour. I've just crossed the Pier Peto stream, which the Skins forded before dawn on the 15th of May, as they probed deep into the heart of the Gustav Line. The Skins benefited from the cover provided by thick morning mist, but were finally confronted by German tanks on Tamburini Hill. Skins commander Barla Breeden called for armoured support, which arrived following the completion of the Pier Peto Bridge. The Skins attacked and took Tamburini by 9:30. The next objective was Point 86, on the other side of what is now the Autostrada to Rome. Just after 10 o'clock, it was pounded by divisional artillery and tank fire. The Skins charged down Tamburini and up to Point 86, which was taken within an hour. They dug in amid a storm of artillery fire. The Skins had penetrated deep into the Gustav Line, but paid a high price. They lost 55 men killed and wounded in the attack. 5 Sherman tanks belonging to the 16th 5th Lancers were destroyed. The London Irish followed the Skins to continue the advance. The mist in the Lyrie Valley had burned off, and it was a brilliantly clear day. German artillery fire became more accurate. Around 3 o'clock in the afternoon of the 15th of May, London Irish commander, Lieutenant Colonel Ian Gough, held an orders group meeting to prepare for the attack. The O Group was hit by concentrated German shelling. Gough was mortally wounded. The commanding officer of the 16th 5th Lancers, John Loveday, was killed outright. G Company commander Major Geoffrey Phillips was seriously wounded. Most of the London Irish Signals team were injured. Horsfall took over command of the London Irish. The attack was postponed until the next morning, when 11th Brigade, on the right, would be ready. Ted O'Sullivan brought up E Company's evening meal. He stayed the night on the front line and shared a trench with his friend Sergeant Eddie Mayo. Close by, Horsfall was in a former German dugout.
I slept for an hour or so in spite of the racket going on around us. Strangely enough, I recall the slight sounds and chats from our signallers beside me, rather than the pandemonium going on outside the dugout.
There was a cloudless sky over the casino battlefield on the morning of the 16th of May. Ted O'Sullivan returned to the battalion's supply base. In E Company, London Irish 9 Platoon Commander, Lieutenant Nicholas Mosley, was serving breakfast when he was hit in the wrist by shrapnel. Mosley was sent for treatment. Eddie Mayo took over command of his platoon. At 9 o'clock, the artillery barrage began. Horsfall said the landscape ahead vanished under a black thundercloud, pierced by the dancing orange lightning of the shell bursts. The bombardment advanced at 100 yards a minute, over German positions about 1,000 yards to the front. It was the London Irish Rifles' signal to attack. The three forward companies rose from their trenches and advanced towards the fortified hamlet of Synagoga. They kept as close as possible to the barrage. The London Irish were led by H Company. Its commander was Desmond Woods, a regular army officer from Malahide in Dublin.
One tried to move from one shell hole to the next, and I remember diving into a shell hole and a chap, one of the riflemen from my company HQ, landed on top of me. I said, "Get up, we must go on." There was no movement. He was dead. He had a bit of shrapnel through his neck. We were lying flat on the ground, as close as we could get to it, and there was me beside German prisoners. We were all made of human flesh. All dignity had gone.
To the left, Eddie Mayo rose from his foxhole and shouted, "Nine platoon, follow me." His men got up and advanced. Mayo's company commander, Mervyn Davis, was at the centre of the action.
The initial advance was through a cornfield. The corn was golden and very tall, and it was a shame to see the tanks mowed down. We did not realise that we came under enemy fire until we saw the odd man fall.
E Company headed towards the wood to the left of Synagoga. When the barrage ended, it was in the open. The company dashed forward and took about 60 Panzer Grenadiers prisoner. H Company, meanwhile, was fighting to capture the hamlet. Shermans moved through the advancing soldiers, but the leading tanks were knocked out by 88mm guns. H Company Corporal Jimmy Barnes, a 20-year-old from County Monaghan, led his section against the self-propelled gun in the hamlet. While Rifleman Bean tried to cover him, Barnes rushed the gun with grenades. A burst of gunfire killed him. Woods unsuccessfully recommended Barnes for a posthumous Victoria Cross. Bean was awarded the military medal. Others killed in the attack included Lieutenant Michael Clark, who had been awarded the Military Cross in the battle for the Simeto River in Sicily during August 1943. He was 23. Desmond Woods was organised in H Company when London Irish commander John Horsfall came up to Synagoga in a tank.
He said, "Desmond, well done. You've reached your objective." I said, "Yes, sir, but at what cost? I've lost two of my platoon officers and about two-thirds of my company."
For his role in the attack on Synagoga, Woods was awarded a bar to the military cross he'd been awarded while serving in the Royal Ulster Rifles in Palestine in 1938. In the wood, Eddie Mayo and Corporal Edward O'Reilly from County Cavan, who had been awarded the military medal in Sicily, urged their platoon to dig in. They jumped into their own foxhole. A stray Nebelwerfer hit it. They were instantly killed. E Company pressed on to Colli Menace, the location of a farm building. German infantry, backed by tanks, counterattacked from the direction of the Pierpetto. The London Irish were joined by Vickers machine gun crews from D Company of the 1st Battalion of the Kensington Regiment, the heavy fire support unit of the 78th Division. By dusk, the German attacks had petered out. The survivors of H Company, along with F Company, pushed forward another 400 yards to the hamlet of Pinchera. As night fell, Ted O'Sullivan returned to E Company with hot food. The battlefield was lit up by blazing tanks and buildings. He found riflemen in Mayo's platoon weeping in the darkness. Lance Corporal Gerald Keegan, a Lancashire Irishman, aged 21, who had been made acting sergeant in Mayo's place, was carving tender words on a cross for their leader's grave. It read, "Sergeant Eddie Mayo, MM, the greatest sergeant that ever breathed." Keegan was recommended for the military medal himself, but was killed by German shellfire 6 days later. It had been a day of extreme violence. Brigadier Scott said German machine gun fire on the 16th of May was the most concentrated he had ever seen. London Irish casualties were 9 officers and more than 100 NCOs and riflemen. It had taken about 100 prisoners and killed about 100 more. 9 German tanks were knocked out. The next phase of the advance called for the Fogs to attack north from Sinagoga and harass German traffic on Highway 6. It was to start on the morning of the 17th of May. The night before, C Company Commander Franklin Vale wrote to his wife Olive describing the days before the attack began.
"I had a lot of trouble with one platoon that day. 4 men deserted and it began to look as if the real rot was setting in. So I had the whole company together and gave a real hard-hitting talk straight from the shoulder. I spoke of the white-livered, gutless skunks who deserted their comrades, painted a very grim picture of what would happen to them, told them that my risk was far greater than theirs, that I would rather die and know my wife and daughter could hold up their heads for the rest of their lives, knowing I had done my job, rather than live disgraced and bring shame and misery on my family. I spoke quietly, but put every ounce of force I possessed into what I was saying, and delivered at such a time and a place, it had a very big effect. Some of the NCOs told me afterwards it was just what was needed, and morale went up enormously, and since then, they've been quite happy and cheerful. All my love and kisses, darling wife, to you and Valerie. Your ever devoted husband, Lawrence."
Franklin Vale's company and D Company, commanded by Major Jimmy Clark, led the attack. It began at 7 o'clock with a crawling artillery barrage and was supported by a squadron of Sherman tanks from the 165th Lancers. All objectives were taken by the end of the afternoon. After nightfall, a Fox patrol crept to the railway to Rome. They fired illuminated mortars over Highway 6 to disrupt German troops retreating from Casino. But there had been more bitter losses. Shrapnel killed Lancers squadron commander Robert Gill as he was mounting his tank that morning. Around the same time, a shell hit C Company's headquarters team as they prepared to advance. Lawrence Franklin Vale was mortally wounded. On the next day, one of his platoon commanders, Douglas Room, wrote to Olive Franklin Vale.
"Dear Olive, I have some very sad news to give you. Yesterday morning, about 7:45, Laurie died. I was about 5 yards from him when the shell exploded, so I was with him immediately. I am certain he was not conscious after he had been hit, and so suffered no pain. He died in a few minutes. There is so little I can say to help you in your great loss, but all my heart and sympathy is with you. I'm still numb about it, and very grieved. He was such a wonderful officer, and the men loved him."
While the Fogs were pushing north on the afternoon of the 17th of May, the Skins advanced towards Piemarola, a mile to the west. They attacked at 6:15 in the evening. Some crossed the Birpetto on telegraph poles they used as a bridge. The London Irish joined the attack, and the fighting was swiftly over. Skins commanding officer Barla Breedham was wounded in the legs by shrapnel, but continued to direct the attack, strapped to the bonnet of a jeep until he passed out. Breeden was awarded the Distinguished Service Order. Major John Kerr, who took over command of the battalion, was awarded the Military Cross. London Irish Commander John Horsfall was also awarded the Distinguished Service Order. The capture of Piermarola on the evening of 17th of May meant that the Gustav Line in the Lyre Valley was broken. The next morning, the Polish Corps took Monastery Head itself. The Battle of Casino was over. Around 75,000 people from a dozen nations were killed and wounded in the battles for Casino. The Commonwealth War Graves Cemetery at Casino contains the graves of almost 4,000 British and Commonwealth soldiers killed at Casino and elsewhere in the Italian campaign. Another 4,000 are commemorated on memorial panels at the cemetery. It is the final resting place for 48 members of the Irish Brigade who died in the advance through the Lyre Valley on the 15th to 17th of May 1944. At Casino on the 16th of May 2019, the commemoration of the 75th anniversary of the Italian campaign was attended by London Irish Rifles veteran Charles Ward, then aged 100, and his daughter Diane. He placed poppy wreaths on the graves of former comrades, including Sergeant Eddie Mayo, who had died 75 years ago that very day. More than 1,000 men are buried in the Polish cemetery north of Monte Cassino, on the ground where many of them died. Tens of thousands of pilgrims visit the cemetery every year. The German cemetery contains the final resting place of 20,000 men who died here and elsewhere in southern Italy in 1943 and 1944. Allied forces broke out of Anzio on the 23rd of May. The Hitler Line, 5 miles behind the Gustav Line, was breached 2 days later. Fifth Army Commander General Mark Clark entered Rome on the 4th of June. 2 days later, Allied landings began in Normandy. Meanwhile, the 8th Army had been pursuing the German rearguard north and east of Rome. While the Irish Brigade fought its way north, its staff captain, Charles Bowen Colthurst, a member of a family from Cork, and Brigade Chaplain Dan Kelleher contacted the Irish ambassador to the Holy See. Kelleher had been recommended for the Military Cross for bravery in Kyra in April. The suggestion was made that the Irish Brigade should be the first Allied formation to be granted an audience with Pope Pius XII. It happened in the Vatican on the 12th of June 1944.
Each company provided 6 men and I made sure that I was there. We arrived at St. Peter's Square and the detachment of about 130 soldiers, including the composite pipe band, entered the Vatican. We climbed the carpeted stairway, passing the Swiss guards in their Michelangelo uniforms, and filed into the papal chamber. As each person entered, they were given a rosary and a papal blessing document. My neighbours included sergeants who were members of the Orange Order.
The Pope arrived at 9 o'clock in the morning and greeted the Irish Brigade.
Dearly beloved sons, we bid you welcome. You belong to the nation which has ever belonged to God's Church since St. Patrick. We are well aware of the good which the Irish have done in spreading the faith from the shores of their Green Isle into many nations. We greet you and bless you with all our heart's affection and your dear ones at home. God be with you always.
The Mass Brigade band then played the Killaloo. The Pope tapped his foot to the beat of the martial music and obviously enjoyed the alien sound. He then blessed our rosaries and other objects, and each of us mounted the dais to kneel and kiss his ring.
Afterwards, the Irish Brigade pipe band beat the retreat on St. Peter's Square, where a large crowd, including Irish priests and nuns, had gathered. Ted was master of ceremonies for a mass in the Blessed Sacrament Chapel in St. Peter's.
I had served mass in many strange places, but to do so in St. Peter's Cathedral was beyond belief. After, we were dismissed to have the day free until the afternoon. I toured the Basilica open-mouthed at this splendor in the middle of a war, and explored Rome on foot, seeing the Colosseum and other famous historical sites.
The audience with the Pope on the 12th of June was unforgettable, but the Irish Brigade had a war to fight north of Rome, and that's where we're going next, for part 6 of All My Brothers, the story of the Irish Brigade in the Second World War.